Awesome. The topic is going to be design patterns for building network agnostic apps. The initial intention was to do it for a very generic design pattern talk, which is covering iOS and Android. And later I remembered that I haven't done anything in iOS. In the fear of getting caught, I just updated the topic to just say design patterns for network agnostic Android apps. Whether I know about Android, we'll know in YouTube. Okay, so this is the first talk for this conference. Fragments is a new initiative. And before going to the talk, I thought of rambling around. How many of you are iPhone users? I'm not talking about iOS developer, I'm talking about iPhone users. How many of you are keen to find out what is getting launched tonight? So, should I do the original talk or just do all the leaks and then finish up in the next 15 minutes? Okay, there is a reason for bringing up this slide in an Android talk. The reason is this man. 10 years ago, actually slightly more than 10 years ago, it's almost like 10 and a half years ago, when he launched this phone, I don't think the world realized that many of our salaries are going to be based on that particular event. The whole mobile world changed from then, and in fact, I would say iOS gave that tough competition to Android in terms of 2-3 years of lagging in features, and that whole evolution and the whole new mobile world, which is ruling the entire community right now and employing so many developers like us, was probably started that particular event. Speaking about a motivating person, how many of you know this person? She mentioned this in many of her ads, saying India has the fastest and widest network which works perfectly from Shimla to Tamil Nadu. She conveyed that in many annoying ways to us, many of her ads, but unfortunately we still see this. When the network is bad, which is a regular scenario, we see that infinite loading progress bar in our apps, and when the network is completely gone, which is like a slightly less regular scenario, we see that check your network connection. So these two are the blames that we keep on our users, and our users cry when they see these things. The intention of this talk is not to remove that completely. The intention of this talk is to ensure that we can do around these and then still provide great experience irrespective of the network condition. We will go through a few standard design patterns. We will also go through some of the best practices which some of the product companies actually came up with. When employed, the expectation is you are going to provide that experience which is not very different based on the network condition. Whether it is like available, not available, screwed up, nearly screwed up. So obviously, this is not the right thing to do. The intention is not to provide this experience to the users all the time. And what we actually intend to provide is something like this. It should load at least in a matter of a second or so. But keeping that LTE result on the website, we see the 2G behavior, we can actually go through a movie review completely before it comes up. So in the interest of time, and I don't want you people to sleep off, so I will go ahead and continue, because this video is going to take another 30 seconds before the results show up completely with images. So once again, obviously this is not expected, this is not what we want to provide to our users. We cannot just improve their network speeds. Somebody tried, named Geo. We all know how much they are successful of. I think we just forgot to understand a simple mathematical logic, that if you have a huge pipe coming in, and if you are putting in that 100 pipes, it makes sense. But if you are, that information which is coming in that huge pipe, if you are distributing in 1 million pipes, we all get 2G in the name of 4G. And how many of you are getting very good 4G connection in India all the time? There are two extremely satisfied customers. I think we should all listen to them and take the class in terms of how to live happily in life. So most of the time I do not attempt a video call in our mobile data, and whenever I attempted, it showed why I shouldn't. And Wi-Fi is always there in office for free at Uber, so it was not a major problem. But considering the scenarios where that is not the case, let's try to define quickly what is a network agnostic app. Finally, coming to the topic. A network agnostic app is supposed to behave similarly in different network conditions. You assume that these two mobiles were in different network conditions, but they are providing similar experience. And that is the tick mark that we want to achieve right now. Is this first time? Is this never happened before? Not really. These two famous apps, which are now used by our parents most of the time, have done that well, except for the first blue guy killing our battery. So WhatsApp and Facebook actually have applied a lot of best practices around network agnostic implementation of their app. We have stolen some of the design patterns here. We'll go through them next few moments. Before just going there, how many of you are regular users of WhatsApp here? Okay, awesome. How many of you have paid that 50 rupees subscription in your life? We really need to learn from you, sir. There are two people. I think I will find some way to give some credits to them. Old users. That was not expected. This is expected. Okay. Okay. So the first design pattern is pretty simple. I wanted to start with something which we all do implicitly. A cacheable content with time to live. So Android developers, if you are using OKHTTP and if you are using OKHTTP cache in your app, then you are already doing this internally. So this pattern is nothing but whenever you make a network call, listen to the server. Server provides you some TTL. Keep that response till that TTL is expired. Until that time, do not disturb server again and again. Just use that response for any of your upgrade. So what is the advantage and how is it going to impact in terms of network agnostic implementation? The difference is when you are having probably an image which is having a TTL of 3 months, and then if you are going to use that image in every launch, then probably for the next 3 months, once you fetch one, don't have to fetch it again, and it's always going to be available. So few primary things: the server needs to add TTL for this in all the responses, and the client is supposed to cache that data if that is valid, that TTL is valid, and when the TTL is expired, it should clear it up. And the last, the important one, you can extend this design pattern to ignore any network response. Essentially, if you have cache, use it, otherwise do not use it. So there is a force cache option available in OKHTTP. This is specific to OKHTTP, but you can apply this design pattern anywhere. This is just taken from our friend Jake Wharton's website, R-Square's website more precisely. This is their architecture in terms of how things are actually managed in OKHTTP. So they have one request side or input side, and they have two data sources, cache and network. So for cache to be available, you need to explicitly set it. That is an important point. But otherwise, with this approach, you have that flexibility to get the data from cache if server is setting your TTL and things like that. And also, your application is not disturbing the network or relying on the network a lot of time. Honestly, if you do this properly in your app, most of the network calls are probably, just to give a wild ballpark number, 60 to 70% of the network calls will be avoided if you are doing this properly in your app all the time, which is compared to when you are not doing it. Like, if you have not set TTL at all, if you are not setting that header from backend, and if you are using OKHTTP cache, you will probably end up making another 70% of the API calls. That's the average. So, this is a flow diagram. In the interest of time, I will skip it because this is probably very boring. And these slides are going to be available. You can always have a look at it at any point of time. Quickly move on to the next one. The design pattern around content versioning and 304 response. HTTP 304 is a code which comes into picture when you are requesting a particular resource, you already have a version of a resource, and there is no update in the server. So essentially, server just replies back saying, okay, you have the latest or whatever is supposed to be you are having, just continue. How is it going to impact in your network agnostic story? That when you have a cache maintained with whatever recent version of information that is available, and if you are going to do this whenever app is launched or when you are navigating to a particular flow, then this API call can happen just in the background, irrespective of the network condition. If the network is not available, just don't make the network call. You will continue to use the version which is available. And whenever the new version is available, whenever you make this API call in the background, you get that information, it is available for your next plan. So for the user, he is just consuming the previous data, there is no change, and there is no loss in terms of experience, or it's not like an infinite progress bar coming in waiting for the response to find out whether that is the latest data or not. And the important part of it is it fetches only if the content is changed, which also means you are going to save in terms of network data. So if you are having a content app, which is like a news app, e-commerce app, some feed-based apps, where you have multiple categories, then this actually comes into picture a lot. And in fact, the example that we had seen before, the Movies DB experience. If you see the left one and the right one, the left one is without the categories versioned and stored. The right one is with the categories versioned and stored. Since when the app comes up, at least it will not show that complete blank screen to the user, making him think things are completely broken. It will give that feeling that it is partially broken. So whether partially broken is good, of course not. We are going to see another design pattern later which will solve the problem. This is the flow diagram for this. Once again, the key player is content manager, and the cache is the one which helps storing the information. skipping this slide in terms of videos. So the other important design pattern, which actually came into picture long back, but it's been advertised by Google very greatly in the recent times, in the name of service worker and background sync, is prefetching information. So essentially, user behavior in emerging markets is always like we move around a lot and we get good network connectivity when we don't need it, and we get very pathetic network connectivity when we need it. And just to utilize that amazing behavior, we do prefetch when it is available. We keep all the resources and everything ready, and we use it when the user needs it. Prefetching and updating in the background, for now, if you take the progressive web apps into consideration, it works well in browsers like Chrome, but the design pattern is pretty generic in terms of you maintain a manifest which is returns you the current set of resources that you want to download, and you download them whenever network is available and probably user is connected to Wi-Fi, and whenever a user connects again, you are actually preserving them from your local cache. So essentially, it doesn't matter at all whether the user is connected to a good connectivity or not, you will still be able to provide that good experience to the user. Progressive web apps, yeah, they follow this approach. You can use, download them in Wi-Fi and avoid the data consumption. So there is another call out to be done here. Because you are going to use Wi-Fi for those majority of download, if you have written that logic that way, then you may also end up reducing in terms of data cost to the user, because a good chunk of your download has already happened in Wi-Fi, which is non-metered, and the remaining things happen in the meter network. I used to have this misconception that because Jio is available, nobody is facing any data issue anymore. I learned from my friends recently that they are still running into data balance being emptied. I guess there are many things to download in the internet these days. Jio is not actually solving that problem completely. We are still running into the data limits. So please be cautious around that part and do not penalize the user. So this is the design pattern which is for the service worker. I just kept this block diagram for the context. Essentially, service worker fetches the data when you are having the background sync enabled, and when the app is a progressive web app is opened by the user, it can decide whether the content will be served by the service worker or from network. A generic flow diagram to achieve the same behavior without worrying about service workers and progressive web apps, and this can be done for any platform as such. I understand iOS will not, iOS does not support that background service directly, but still, you can maintain this manifest and then downloading resources logic, and then you can trigger them whenever app is opened. So they will be downloaded in the background in iOS as well, and then they will be ready when you launch the app again later. Okay, next is another design pattern which is actually done very, very well by WhatsApp. How many of you have probably used WhatsApp when the network is very flaky or almost not there? Have you tried sending chat messages to your connections when network is not there? Have you ever seen it crying, saying network not available, won't ask your Jio provider, all those things? The best thing that they had done in WhatsApp is probably avoiding that retry, tap to retry button in their messenger. I think in most of the other messengers, you will see that irritating thing that we are not able to deliver it right now, we'll please tap to retry. and LinkedIn is father of that. I mean, we want to send that message. Send it when you can. And why are you even asking me to tap to retry again as if I will change my mind after 5 minutes? Maybe for those people, WhatsApp is not the best tool. Anyways, so how they do that is pretty simple. They know that you just want to send that message. It's an asynchronous operation. It doesn't matter whether it takes few milliseconds or some more time. They end up providing you that option of sending that message. When you tap on that send button, let's quickly go to this. So just for trying something, I sent a message. The first one, if you see, I'm not very sure if people at the end are able to see the status there. So if you are sending a message without network, it will just give you that history icon or whatever, trying out icon, and later after a few moments, whenever network is available, it will send that message and then it will update the status. How is it different from tap to retry? We all know. It's just that we have to be there and then retry, and this is like a helper who is doing it for you. And this provides that seamless experience where the user who is actually receiving the message, even if he is not online, I remember even if you guys have seen, like few years back, the messengers used to tell us that the other guy has gone offline, you cannot send the message anymore, right? WhatsApp has removed all those barriers and screwed our life. The flow diagram for it, actually this is pretty simple. So we actually kind of maintain a class name Lazy API Manager, where whenever you want to make a network call for which you are not really worried about the response immediately, but you want that to be successful, you just post it to this guy. This guy maintains in a persistent cache. He makes the network call in a batched manner or some other way later. Then he gets the data back and you get everything ready. You get everything done at a later point of time without even knowing when it is done. If you hear that story again, this is what happens with analytics SDKs. So you actually post all your events when you are offline, online, whichever line, and it stores everything in a DB and it batches those requests, those 1000 irrelevant events that you are firing, all of them are batched together and they are sent to the server, which we never look at it. How many of us are consuming all the events that we are hitting to the server and make sense out of it? How many of us are using 50% of the data that we are hitting as part of analytics? Two people. How many of us are using 10% of the data? There are 8 layers in the room. I didn't want to call you a liar, sir. Directly. That brings us to another friend. How many of you are having Facebook app installed on your device? How many of you are still using Facebook? I think you guys have made a good decision, but let's still go through the design pattern that they have done, which might be useful later in your life. So the Facebook feed, which is getting generated as per one of their blog posts, is not anymore cooked by server. And this is a pretty good design pattern, and I would really encourage everyone who is doing a content based app to evaluate this in your setup. May not be applicable directly for you, but at least you will be able to apply a few of the learnings from whatever they have done or whatever they claim they have done, and it will be very useful. So the first thing, obviously, we want to see the list of cards to be shown up on our mobile client. That is our focus. Generally, it comes directly from server, because server is intelligent enough, only intelligent enough to order the cards in the way that user should see. This is that misconception most of the product managers have. I hope there are no product managers here. And in the mobile client, instead of going to the server, it essentially goes to another local manager, which is like a pool of stories. You can assume for them, they have considered this as a passive component, but you can assume that this pool of stories is an active component which is actually deciding which card to be shown. And it is not based on what is the most recent card which is available. So if we go to the next step, they are deciding based on these various factors. The ranking score which is coming from server is one of the parameters, but they try to see whether this particular story type is going to work out for the user at this point of time, whether the story is completely good. For example, a card which is someone's birthday wish, having some GIF and some few other resources, probably comes as a metadata with only text and few URLs. Yet card is completely cooked when every resource which is required to show that card completely on screen are available. So this pool of stories are the guy who is actually managing all these cards internally verifies whether all the metadata and all the resources required to show that cards are available, and then take a call on adding that to the feed. So if you have seen in the recent times, Facebook does not show those empty images or random cards I used to get. But we do not see a lot of missing images. We do not see a lot of mismatching content in the card, just because they always ensure that a cooked card is shown. And also, there is another criteria related to the network condition. So, for example, if you are on a slower network, even if server gave you a lot of video cards, the client will actually filter them out for that session, and it will show you mostly image cards and textual cards which are ready at that point of time. And if you have an extremely good connection, they have a connection class written by themselves, they have an open source library. So they will provide that information, they will decide based on the information available from the card to show or not based on the current network condition. So essentially, this app is not network agnostic in the implementation. It doesn't show everything irrespective of the network, but it provides that experience to the user that there is no mismatch or empty card shown to the user. It's always a card which is like working condition. And if it is a video card and if you are in a slower network, it ensures that it doesn't even show it up. And this ensures that experience which is clean. So obviously, whenever it needs some more stories to be fetched, it talks to the newsfeed backend, it fetches them and it starts processing them in the background. This might be one of the reasons why Facebook is still one of the best battery killers. And I used to always have this conspiracy theory that Facebook has made a deal with all the OEMs to ensure that they take care of the battery and you always have to update your phone every year. We don't. The last part, and probably the important part which gives you that flexibility in terms of when you are completely off network, how does this information come out? That is provided by this persistent cache, and this persistent cache is just keeping all the cards which are ready or partially ready, which were served from backend before, cooked by the pool of stories for future use. So essentially, if you have seen in some scenarios, you might see in Facebook app or Facebook feed, you will see some cards which are very old, a few weeks old at time. That might be because those are stored in the persistent memory and they came up, or probably some annoying friend of yours just liked that photo and it bumped up the ranking. Moving on to another design pattern, or this is more like a technology pattern. There are many options that we can provide in our app by providing network interactions. that might need mobile data. Okay, great. Can I? So the slides which are going to be from here are as useful as which were till now. So you can take a call. Okay. So the SMS and USSD based transactions are pretty simple. If you have seen *99# in your mobile, you will be able to dial that and then kind of make UPI transactions to any other account or buy stuffs. And actually this flow explains railway ticket booking, and the next one actually explains transaction in terms of money transfer and other things. The flow is pretty simple. We can try it out. Once again, in the interest of time, I'll skip this and just move on to the next design pattern, which is the final one, thankfully for all of you. And this design pattern is prefetch and pull notifications. Pretty simple. Our GCM is not reliable, our network is not reliable, our users are not reliable, everything is unreliable. So we want to provide a reliable mechanism to send notifications to the users, and pull notifications are going to provide that flexibility for you. So essentially you fetch notifications once in a while, and with those notifications you also get the show time and expiry time, so that you can actually schedule future notifications and then they will be available to the users when they, even if they are not connected to network. If you are taking a sports app and if you want to notify user about some game being started, you can send this notification even much earlier and say you can schedule this notification for a particular time, and this will be available. So this information need not even come through push. It can be just fetched by the app and then stored and then shown when the right time comes. That is about it. And the next one is target ready notification, which is nothing but the immediately after receiving the notification, you also fetch all the resources required to load the landing page. And in that sense, you achieve that flexibility that when the user is opening that notification, it may not need network connection or it may not need a faster network to show the content. You will have everything ready. And that's about it. That's about this particular design pattern. Once again, we have the flow diagram. I work for Uber, and we are having a booth here. So once again, we can always have a catch up and understand what we are doing, and we would like to discuss with you guys how we want to improve the cab booking experience in India and all other emerging markets. Yes, for your good sake, I have reached to the end of the slide. And if we have any questions, I'm not very sure if we have time for questions right now. We have. So if you have any questions, please go ahead. I think we are not using that client side feed generation, but otherwise the remaining patterns are used in different modules. We are not using USSD yet directly. So otherwise, I didn't take those examples from our code base because I wanted to keep them generic and call out some of the open source and other popular platforms which are available. But we are almost using most of them. So if you see, if you open the Uber app, most of the time you will get that experience, like it will at least show cabs in the previous position and then it will load the new positions and continue from there. Yes, we are using most of the patterns which I had called out here. Any other questions? Yeah, please go ahead.
So, you know, background restrictions are coming up soon in Android, already in iOS. And if you aggressively use the background, some of them may work quite well. Or is it the case?
No. So, if I understand correctly, all the background restrictions that are being brought in are mainly around those hard scheduled background services or services which are running for longer time. Essentially, they do not want to block the experience of the user who is actually using another app in the foreground and you are screwing up the background. So their preferred approach, and in fact, in most of these design patterns, you should just stick to something like a Firebase job dispatcher. And if you do that, you will essentially get that flexibility in terms of because Google Play Services is running that show, it will know when to trigger your service, and it will, you have options like on start, and then in the on stop you can say I want to run this service for some more time, and then once your service is done you can say job finished and things like that. So it is not at all a problem, and it is in fact recommended. You can use job dispatcher to do lot of your work. Just you have to be careful in terms of fetching too much of data or things like that. Like sometimes the interest of keeping the experience amazing, we end up pre-fetching everything in your server. That should be avoided. But otherwise, actually these background restrictions are mainly for those services which affect the performance of foreground apps. That's it. Anything else? Awesome. So, okay. So, even if you have some queries later, we would love to meet you guys. Our Uber team is in our booth. Please do visit us. Please ensure we are not feeling alone. Thank you.